Ian Bremmer, thank you so much for joining me.
Sure, my pleasure.
We've just seen a terror attack in Europe in Manchester at the Ariana Grande concert.
Right.
This is something that many people have said that we're going to see worsening terrorism as we see more and more foreign fighters returning from Syria and other hotspots throughout North Africa and the Middle East. Where do you think this is going? How bad is this potentially going to get?
In the context of lots of other disasters that we see around the world every day, this is comparatively small, but
right.
it gets a lot of attention, and
yes.
we spend a lot of money on it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the biggest danger, of course, is that something like this happens to the United States either at home or to American assets abroad, and that Trump overreacts to it. He has low approval ratings, and he decides to demonize, and he spends an enormous amount of money and gets the United States involved in more intractable conflicts, or both.
Right.
I mean, clearly, the overreaction to 9/11, the profound overreaction to 9/11, was one of the greatest, most consequential sources of damage to America's footprint globally mm-hmm. that has been done. I mean, the great thing about being the world's only superpower is that you can do a lot more damage to yourself than other countries can do to you. That's
mm-hmm.
also the bad thing.
Right.
And that's what worries me the most, is that, I mean, yes, it's horrifying when you see a young radical Islamic terrorist blow up a bunch of teenage girls. You want to talk about something that strikes, you know, sort of to the heart of everything that humanity holds dear.
Right.
It's hard to come up with much worse than this.
Right.
And yet, you know, the reaction has to be solidarity, security, focus, but don't suddenly think, oh my God, we've got to go and fix Syria or fix Iraq, because we're not going to do it. No one is prepared to put that level of commitment, and no one believes they have the solution. So
right.
I think that the danger is precisely the overreaction.
Hmm. I think there's a general perception out there that ISIS and groups like them
yeah.
seem to be more organized and more strategic than we believe they are in terms of what we've seen happen over, you know, terror attacks over the last 15 years. I don't know what your take is on this or not, but when we see an attack on a venue that's, this is somewhere where people go for entertainment, and it's
right.
a choice thing. Transportation, everyone, you know, has to drive a car, or, you know, fly in a plane or take a train. That's something that's, you know, baked into the cake. People do not have to go to NFL games, Major League Baseball, NBA games, stadium events with concerts, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And this seems to be kind of a shift in that direction, which obviously people have been concerned about this for many years. Do you see that sort of thing only increasing? What do you see changing? Or is this, this is a general road we're on, and as you say, don't overreact, but
yeah,
this is
again,
just reality.
I think that I would be much more concerned if that was to hit the United States than I am with Europe. Of course, the UK, with decades of IRA bombings, had become not anesthetized to it,
right.
but, you know, keep calm and carry on came from the UK, World War II,
mm-hmm.
And they're capable of dealing with a hell of a lot worse,
right.
frankly. So I think the impact that this will have on the UK economy is actually kind of small. I mean, if you want to be, you know, very blunt about it, it's going to be an advantage for Theresa May because it shows leadership
right.
for her. And of course, Corbyn is the antithesis of leadership. So in that regard, especially because her lead had halved of the Conservative Party in the upcoming snap elections in the UK from what it was just a couple of weeks ago, I suspect that you'll see it widen out a little bit again over the course of the coming week on the back of this crisis. Now, the thing that it is true that terrorist organizations are stronger now than they have been before because, you know, of course, their ability to use technology to coordinate, to recruit, to raise money is great, and also because the challenges that exist in their homelands are only growing. But they still haven't displayed a lot of capacity to do damage with cyber. And I'm glad for that, but I talk to experts in this field all the time, and I ask them, are you surprised? They say, it's coming. And that worries me a lot.
What is that going to look like when it comes?
Well, I mean, first of all, their ability to start funding themselves by having cyber capabilities to start stealing significant cash
right.
using criminal networks, that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
The North Koreans are now doing that. The Americans are quite surprised about it.
Right.
The attack on, for example, the SWIFT network with the Central Bank of Bangladesh, which
mm-hmm.
was less than $100 million, but human error could have been $1 billion, right?
Right.
It wasn't a cyber issue, it was a human issue. So You know, when Boko Haram or when ISIS or Al-Qaeda start having that sort of capability, I think that the threat to the United States, because you're not talking about geography anymore, suddenly becomes a hell of a lot greater.
I'm reading a book right now called The Benedict Option that was, that I became aware of it through New York Times, several editorials. And essentially it paints a picture of a post-Christian West that doesn't quite know what it what it believes. Whether that's true or not, we can debate that. However, do Western governments truly have, A, the understanding, and B, the tools to try to undermine this radical Islamist strain that, quite frankly, in my travels in West Africa, Southern Africa, in Asia, even what we're seeing in Europe, this is a growing phenomena. It doesn't seem to be slowing down. Do we have the tools, do governments have the tools to effectively counter this ideology that's coming out there, other than just doing military operations?
Yeah, I think we do. I just don't think you're going to like the answer. I mean, I think that the tools that we have are, and the ones that we're willing to deploy, are less about trying to improve their lives and trying to provide options and alternatives for them that are feasible and sustainable. Mm-hmm. And they're more about tracking them, preventing them from getting into your country, dividing them from local populations, lots of surveillance, that sort of thing. So, I mean, I think, yes, you've got the military option, but you also have the suppression and the reduction of the franchise.
Right.
In other words, what Israel-Palestine, Israel's solution for Palestine was not purely a military solution. It was also overwhelmingly a build walls solution, divide and conquer, or divide and separate and make yourself safe. And I think that that's something you're going to see a lot more of from the Americans, certainly from the continental Europeans, those that can afford to do that, so in the European core. That doesn't in any way alleviate the challenge of tens of millions of young Muslim men that are increasingly inclined towards more radical options for expressing their frustrations.
Right.
That expression is, again, with the exception of the cyber issue, it's likely to be geographically pretty contained,
right,
which means big problem for Southeast Europe, for Turkey, big problem for the Middle East, smaller problem for Europe, US, Canada, Japan, functionally ignorable if the governments can choose not to make it political.
To avoid the political, politicizing the issue itself.
Right. I mean, that's the big danger. And one of the things that made Trump's trip to the Middle East so successful is that he chose not to politicize an issue that he has been politicizing consistently. He won the presidency in part on that. And he certainly experienced his first 100 days in part on that with the first failed executive order, and now we'll see, on immigration. But he goes to Saudi Arabia. He wasn't talking about radical Islamic terror, didn't use that actual term. He was, you know, couldn't say nicer things about, you know, the three religions in harmony and about working with all of these governments that heretofore we've had some significant problems in terms of tracking their own support and funding and proselytization, particularly of Wahhabism internationally. He chose not to do that. And I mean, we got an Iran issue, which is separate.
Sure.
But leaving that aside, this was the kind of thing you would have expected from, dare I say, Obama. And ultimately, that's better for the American economy. The way you really hurt the American economy is by politicizing things that are going to require enormous wasting of money and political capital.
Well, thank you so much for your time and your insight, Ian.
Yeah, my pleasure.
Appreciate it. Click the link below to download the SIC 2017 bundle with exclusive insights from the conference and more.